It's really hard to be down on the tour of Flanders, so I'm going to get the grumpy part out of the way first. I don't like the new course very much. Back when, that is 1975 through 2 years ago, the race tore through Oudenaarde whipsawing around corners on a frenzied passage of six leg-smashing climbs and 23 kilometers, like some sadomasochistic game of Flandrian Pokemon. The densest comparable section in the new race takes place over nearly 40k and occurs not in a single white-knuckled pass, but on more or less regular laps of the same terrain. How does this affect the tactics of the event? Let's watch the race play out. I'll pick up the action on the Tyenberg, favorite launch pad of reigning champ Tom Bonin, who unfortunately found himself crumpled on the side of the road for the second consecutive week. But even if he hadn't crashed out early, we still wouldn't have seen any fireworks over this berg, because despite its proclivity towards creating awesome races, it's been placed a ludicrous 143 kilometers from the end. But like any classic, we had riders dodging islands, getting rubber-banded at the back, and of course, letting the day-long break wait, Europe car, what are you doing? You realize there's 120k to go, right? Okay, drive it up the Molenberg. Oh, wait, there goes Greipel. Okay, you're gonna put two riders across? Well, that's... oh, Greipel's attacking again. Now you just have one. And here we are on the next climb, and Lotto's sending Marcus Seberg across, and now they've got three dudes and they're yo-yoing you, sending their fresh riders forward, and leaving their tired one to sit up and make gaps. Well, you did a good job closing that one, but there's another. And here's Cannondale's Ted King and the entire Radio Shack team to make tempo. Brake set, Europe car, 90k to go, and you're still not in it. You could credit able pacemaking from Cancellara and Sagan's teams, or the need to refuel and degear, but I think things got kinda boring before each finish loop because of this big dumb road they put the race on. And despite a battle for places, mind the children, please! Each time it came back onto the Eau de Quermont, the only real action was riders dropping off the back. Yeah, there were a handful of flyers, and yes, one of them even made it to the break, but none really stirred the favorites. Even on the Koppenberg, which was first stormed by AG2R of all teams, the most notable action was Sagan narrowly avoiding a dismounting rider, and Nicky Terpstra being so far back in the trees the camera could barely find him. Over the next 30 kilometers, Cancellara flatted, and Omega Pharma rider relieved himself, Steendevolder stopped for a wheel change in the middle of the frickin' road, and everyone made it safely back to the field, all on what would have been the most unrelenting, selection-forcing stretch of the 2011 route. At 38k to go, fatigue finally caught up with the break, first dropping to 3 on the Quermont, then 2 over the Paterberg. No action from the field still, as John Degenkolb confirmed with a decidedly unsubtle peek over his shoulder. But no sooner had André Greipel been recaptured than his Lotto teammate, Jürgen Rolantz, leapt free, closing a small gap and then driving a second escape with all the vigor of a man who'd been sitting on and relaxing while his teammates held court up the road. Rolantz and IAM Cycling's Sebastian Hinault caught and then gapped the remaining breakaways before the Belgian powered clear on the final ascent of the Eau de Quermont. But behind him, the favorites finally woke up. Or rather, Fabian Cancellara rode to the front of the field and made every other favorite in the race regret the previous 230 kilometers they'd spent not attacking. Only Sagan could hold Cancellara's wheel to the top of the climb, but check out Omega Pharma's Michał Kwiatkowski in the break for 110 kilometers and still holds a full flight Cancellara to the final 100 meters of the penultimate climb. With the two indisputable favorites bearing down on him, Roland selected to await their arrival in hopes of being the freshest up the final ascent of the day. Nevertheless, he was the first rider dropped, but seemed to better gauge his effort in chasing Cancellara, who is on one of those days where it's really just best to let him go. Over the top, Sagan needed to mentally regroup, Rolantz used the opportunity to do so literally. Ahead, Cancellara steamed on at speeds occasionally in excess of 30 miles an hour. Despite the remaining 13 kilometers of road, that's how it stayed. Cancellara winning solo, Rolantz pulling only as much as necessary to avoid recapture before getting torched by Sagan in the sprint. Though, to be fair, third behind those two is a pretty decent reward for the most tactically active team on the day. That said, with Alexander Kristoff leading in the bunch just seconds behind, I think a serious climb closer to the end might have made things quite a bit more interesting. And I just so happen to know one that might fit the bill. I'm Cosmo Catalano, and that's how the race was won. Of course, if Flanders Classics went back to the old course with all those pretty climbs, they might have to find a distributor who will actually air the race in the US. I never thought I'd have so much trouble trying to pay someone for something.